waiting.
There I am.
Here he is, everybody. Let me adjust my head. Too much. Getting down the...
Ooh.
Garden.
I'm charging my phone so it's all dicked up.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
I mean, I really probably don't have to, but fuck, I'm not gonna. It'll last.
Hooray!
It's an earthquake. It's an earthquake!
Yeah.
Ba 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 ba.
There we go.
Are we steady?
I think so.
All right.
We're going steady.
We are going steady, finally. We're going steady after 20 years of friendship. It's finally happening.
It seems like a lot more than that, too.
20 years.
20 years.
20 years? Is that really even correct?
20?
I guess so, yeah. Yeah. I mean, I've known you longer, but I'd say close friendship, 20 years.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
Wave. Anyways. Wave, wave. I'm waving. This is episode 8. I think it's 8.
It is 8. Yeah, 1-8.
8-8.
We're on Jason Takes Manhattan.
I like that one.
It's a funny one. It's a funny one.
I really only like 6, 7, and 8.
Dude, 3's the best.
You like 3 because you're a dork. Look at those fresh haircuts.
You're not wrong.
Are haircuts fresh?
Mine are. I trimmed that horse shit off my fucking face.
I would say that I got a haircut a week ago.
And then I trimmed my hair. I cut my own hair.
I have a nice Korean man who cuts my hair. His name's Billy. He's great.
I am not Korean.
What?
But I would pay a Korean man to cut my hair. I know, spoiler alert, I'm not Korean.
Yeah, you're spinning a lot on me. Am I spinning on you?
Mm-mm.
Tabitha, tell me who is spinning right now. Is anyone spinning? Me. Give me some spinning updates so I know.
I always feel like it's me.
It's you, it's me, it's not me, it's you.
No, I was trying to connect with my tablet earlier. I think that's why it said I couldn't join. But I don't know.
She says both coming in clearly. Okay, good enough for me. Perfect. Anyways, I'm sorry that I got on late, everybody. And by everybody, I mean all one of you. But I was watching the Warriors-Rockets game and went into overtime. And I needed to watch it because it's important to me. And it did not disappoint. I was very happy.
You know what I left to do this?
Probably something at a Bradner bar.
Yeah. But I was hanging out with Andy and April, Josh and Katie, Caleb and Erica came up. So my brother and his wife were there. And a bunch of other people that I know.
Shout out Josh and Katie, who did not come and see me at Christmas time, but have now somehow managed to use their car to drive it now. So I'm glad that they found the strength and managed to overcome that very intense drive from Dayton to Bradner. I know it's a real rough one. It's like the Oregon Trail. So fucking hard, you know. See people who travel 1,000 miles once a year. Whatever.
Sounds right. It all sounds right. It all checks out.
I appreciate you leaving that fun time at Mad Dogs to come sit here and talk to me about things.
It's Speedways now.
What is it?
It's got a different name now. It's Speedways.
Like a gas station?
Yeah.
Isn't Speedway a gas station?
Yes.
but it's not.
But it's also like a racing thing, I guess.
Jesus Christ. So it has new owners.
Yeah. We actually went to school with her.
We? Or you?
I did. I guess I did.
Well, yeah, that's... How's everybody doing? Were you having a good time?
I was having a good time.
I gotta go sit on my phone.
That's pretty much how it went. And then Lynn and I were walking home because we had a sitter for Vivian. And I was like, man, it was really good seeing everybody. You know, I said goodbye to everybody, I think. And then, like, halfway here, I was like, I didn't get to say goodbye to Andy.
Aww. Like,
so, I forgot to say goodbye to Andy.
He'll probably never forgive you.
Lynn said she was going to try and get him to come down.
Oh.
Him and Amy.
That's all we need.
Those we don't have any.
Those jokers. Didn't ask them to get on a view tonight. Well, Katie actually messaged me and said there's like maybe a special appearance by me, Josh, Katie, and April, blah, blah. And I was like, yeah, right.
Sure. Yeah. There was a whole joke built around all that. It was kind of funny. I would have done it, but we didn't do it. We're not going to do it.
I dare them to try. I'll just end this live video and I'll never live stream again.
They would be the ones to ruin it, wouldn't they?
Actually, I mean, I do.
They said they weren't going to be able to watch until later because they're still down there. So,
I literally just wouldn't accept their video invite. That's how. That's what would happen. I'd be like, nope, ignore.
Yeah.
But we have so many things to talk about.
We do.
Actually, we have two things to talk about. I would rather start with...
We actually talked about me live streaming from the bar, too, which wasn't going to happen.
Yeah, that's too... It's too many distractions, you know?
Well, there's karaoke going on right now.
Oh, God.
So, that's a lot of fun.
Yeah, we don't want
said
that.
No one.
It's weird, because it looks like I have a black eye.
Who are you, Matt Beck?
Oh, my God, Beck is wild, man. Beck has a wild fucking injury like every month. He's like, oh yeah. By the way, everybody on Facebook, I just tore my own fucking leg off. Or it's like,
I told him, do not play ball this year. Please don't fucking play base or don't play fucking softball. Like, you tore your fucking ACL. Like, that shit sucked. You were out for like a minute. Like, just don't do it, dude.
He fucking old as fuck. I was like, you can't be out running around like you're 14.
I'm not even sure that it wasn't like the first game he played either.
It looks so much worse the second photo. And then he made it his profile photo. I think he just like,
like immediately he made it his profile photo.
He started a fucking injury blog, just blogging his injuries, you know, and talking about the medical shit he has to deal with every time he fucking ruins his life for 6 months. Like,
he just...
Dude, he's so accident prone. It's fucking amazing. I've never had any like serious injuries.
Nah, because we're smart and we don't play sports.
Except I have a weird thing in my eye right now.
It's just the lighting, son.
Not the lighting. I'm having a stroke.
Do you smell toast?
My nose is plugged. Who slugged me? It wasn't Courtney this time. So,
ooh. That's a story we haven't told yet.
Yeah, let's save that for another night where we don't have to talk about Game of Thrones and Avengers.
Episode 10, we'll talk about it.
We'll talk about it in episode 666.
The story of our lives.
Which one do you want to start with? I would rather start with Avengers because I feel like Game of Thrones is like less fun to talk about. Also, less to talk about. And it's just Avengers is more fun.
Okay. So we did talk about you know, unpacking a lot and really, like, having to jot down our thoughts on it, because it was, like you said, like 20 movies in one.
Yes, it was like it was a good 3 solid movies in one movie. Yes.
Yeah, I never really got around to writing anything down either.
I kind of made some notes.
Like a chore to me, where it was, this is way too much to do. But we saw it the same weekend, right?
Yeah, well, I saw it the Friday opening day, but I saw like at noon, 12 o'clock.
Okay, so I saw it on a Sunday. And so we're coming out of the same weekend, I guess, with it.
Yeah, and at this point, like anybody who is watching casually later on the YouTube video, we are going to talk about the whole movie. I'm going to tell everything that happens.
Absolutely.
If you have not watched the movie, you can stop watching right now, this video. Come back, watch it a later time. This will also apply for Game of Thrones later, like if you haven't caught up on Game of Thrones. I mean, these are the kind of things that you kind of have to be on top of, like, you know, paying bills. Like, you can't be, like, mad later, like, oh, I waited 3 weeks to watch the biggest movie of all time, and now the whole world is talking about it. I was like, yeah, motherfucker, like, it's been out. It's the biggest thing in pop culture of all time. If you have not seen it, I don't know what to tell you. I don't care. Like I said, we're going to talk about it. And so if you haven't seen it, just fucking turn this off. And also go to the goddamn movie theater, because it's a fucking spectacle.
Be a grown-up for once in your life and go to the movie theater to watch a comic book movie.
Be
so
a
you can listen to us talk about it.
Go watch a 3-hour fucking love letter jerk-off fest to like 20 other movies. Like, go do that. Be an adult. Yeah, I'm just going to fucking start diving into it. I do have some notes to keep me in line with the kind of succession of the movie. We can go through it and start talking about it. First of all, I enjoyed it. I will say that. It was the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen in a movie theater. I've never seen anything like that. I don't think that they will make another one like this. A 3-hour, just like, it's 3 movies. It's 3 short movies put together, and it's like a spectacle. You're just watching something so insane. I can imagine if you haven't seen any of those movies and you fucking sat there and watched that, you would be so fucking confused but also like in awe, because you'd be like, what is this giant fucking thing? Because like, if you didn't know anything about it, you'd just be like, what the fuck am I even watching? It's so weird. It's not a traditional 3-act movie. Like,
no.
It's weird, and it's long, and it's also just a succession of like love letters to fans. Every scene is like a wink and a nod to a previous movie. So if you haven't seen other movies, nothing has an emotional impact on you. Nothing means anything to you. You would just be staring at this. I would actually watch a live taping of people who've never seen any of them MCU movies just watching this movie and being like, what is this? I would love that. That's my
dream. Did you feel like any of it was unnecessary?
No. Because, like I said, it's not a traditional movie. It doesn't have a traditional movie feel. It feels like Disneyland. It feels like it's a whole day of just like, here's everything you like right now. You just deal with it. And it's,
hey, remember all that stuff you wanted?
Emotionally invested. Here you go. Like 10 years. It's like 10 years of fucking shit in your brain. And you're like, oh, fuck. I remember that. This means something. I remember that. And it's like they bombard you with it. Like the emotions and the Easter eggs. It's like nothing you've ever seen. And even like Star Wars, which is comparable to this stuff as far as scale, there's not a Star Wars movie like this. There's no 3-hour fucking love letter Star Wars movie where it's just like,
no.
Hey, remember all those other movies? Force Awakens is pretty close, but it's not 3 hours. And it also sets up a bunch of new stuff. It's the beginning of a story arc, so it does not feel like that. There is nothing that exists like this. It's just like this huge thing that's just like a normal person, which, and that's the thing. Most people watch these movies because it's like bigger than the NFL. You know, it's a huge fucking deal. What part did you leave to go to pee? I actually did not pee during the whole thing. Shout out me.
I surprisingly did not go pee either. I was very amazed by myself.
I didn't drink liquid all morning because I had a 12 o'clock showing, so I didn't drink tea. I usually drink tea in the mornings. I didn't drink tea. I didn't drink water. I didn't have a sip of anything. And it didn't actually bother me because I was just so, like, enthralled and engrossed. And when I was watching, I didn't fucking pay attention. And I was like, I brought a drink, and I never even drank it.
We kind of decided on a whim to go. You fucker. It was essentially our daughter had a sleepover on Friday night, and then she went over to that friend's house on Saturday night. So we kind of discussed it, like, there's no way we're going to take a 7-year-old who's been through 2 sleepovers to this fucking movie. Like, she's not going to be able to sit through all of this. And, hang on 1 second. So we, we both got up on Sunday morning and we were just sitting there, like, staring at each other. And I was like, hey, you want to go watch that? And she was like, should we? And I was like, yeah, I think we should. So, I really didn't want anything ruined for me. I knew I was going to go to work and probably have some shit said to me, and I was going to get really pissy about it.
Yeah.
But, so she was like, well, when's the earliest showing? And I was like, 10:30 is the next one. And, there was another one at 11. She's like, well, let's do the 11 so I can have coffee. And I was like, cool. You know, wake up, whatever. So we actually got to the theater at 10:30, and there was, like, hardly anybody there. So we, you know, felt like we kind of had beaten that Sunday rush. Like, everybody was still in church or something, or eating breakfast. And I didn't even pay for it. Like, every year for my birthday at work, they give us vouchers for movie tickets.
Right.
And so I used those. We get inside the theater and, like, turn the corner, and it's just fucking packed.
Of course.
Everybody was already in there.
Yeah, it's so, the biggest thing of all time.
We ended up getting, like, halfway decent seats, too. Like, we were second row from the back. About 6 seats deep. It's normally where I like to sit anyway. Dude, that movie didn't even start until almost noon anyway. Like, all the trailers and bullshit that fucking went on.
We got slammed with fucking IMAX trailers, because we saw an IMAX. And IMAX has special trailers. They literally had a Godzilla trailer that was like, no kidding, a 5-minute scene from the Godzilla, new Godzilla movie. Just straight.
You fucking scared?
Yeah. So the trailer was like 8 minutes. They did this stupid 20-year anniversary of X-Men movies trailer, plus the Dark Phoenix trailer right after that. So that was like another 7 minutes. There was like a half hour of trailers. I was like,
did they do are they doing the Batman movies in IMAX? You know how they're putting all the fucking Batman movies in the theater?
I don't know.
I can't remember what month that's in, but they're doing, like, all the Batman movies.
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't heard that, but I will not go.
I think the shitty George Clooney one?
I own most of those movies. That's all I need. But I might actually go see Avengers again this next week when things kind of die down again.
We got to go see it again because I got to take the older kids. I don't think they've seen it yet. So,
what are your favorite seats in the theater? I definitely never sit second row from back. I sit in the back row, the furthest back row, because I don't like to hear people behind me. So I always reserve seats in the final back row. Because then you only have to hear people on your sides. Because you rarely hear people in front of you unless they're talking. But, like, chewing and moving around behind you is so strong. So I always
sit. Yeah. If I can get those back row seats, or like the second row seats from the back, there's always like a good gap to the next level. Like they really put you up in that space. So I'm in the same boat. I like to be up that way.
Yeah, most of the theaters I go to are reserved seating, so it's like if the back row is sold out, I'll buy another time because I don't want to fucking sit in the middle. I don't want to. It's bad enough there's so many people, but to have them behind you, it's like moving their feet, and then also when people talk behind you, it goes directly into your ears more audibly than people in front of you. I feel like so you have like a wall behind you, and so there's nothing. There's no people. There's not fucking rows of people. That's the best. That's the best place for me. Because I hate people and I want everyone on earth to die. So I don't want to sit there.
Especially at the movies.
Especially at the fucking movies. People are talkers. We had a couple talkers in Avengers.
Really?
That. Yeah. All right, let's talk about this stupid movie. I wrote like a lot of things. I'm just going to start talking about them and you can...
Okay. Hang on a second. I didn't pee during the movie, but I got to pee now.
Oh, God. Here we go.
Hey, I was at the bar and I had a bunch of beers, so...
Oh, cool.
Give me a minute. Just give me a second, all right?
I'll give you 4 seconds.
4 seconds? That's so many.
Hey, so well, many.
Oh, and I got a new bathroom figure. So when I'm gone, you got somebody to talk to. Oh, hopefully he stands up. Hopefully he stands up to what we need.
You've been spinning this whole time, so on my end, like I don't even see you.
So I think I peed already. He's not falling off. God damn it.
I'll get to watch this later though when I fucking make the edit and then oh, yeah, there it is. Okay. Courtney just left, so that means if anybody wants to chime in with things, I won't start in on the Avengers stuff until he gets back as far as, like, the 100 fucking points I want to make about it. If anybody has any questions, was it an alien? Can't see it. I think he gave up. Yeah, I don't think he actually posted it up. He's still spinning on my end, so, like, I just see a circle. I don't know what the deal is. But if you guys say he's fine, then, you know, whatever, that's fine. But, fuck, I don't see shit. But, yeah, you know, anybody else? Did everybody see Avengers? Are you going to see the movie again? Yeah, I already mentioned that. You weren't paying attention. I'm going to see it next week. With hopefully with a dude named Zekmo that I know here. I should text him and tell him to get on. He's a cool guy. Hopefully we'll see it. I was gonna see it again this week, maybe, but it's like you want to wait till the crowd's gonna die down. I don't want to fucking like sit with a bunch of people again. I'd like to go when it's moderately. What am I drinking? That's a good story. I saw it opening day as well. I'm drinking a very terrible. Very strong whiskey. Booker's is some garbage my old boss got me. Won't get into that too much, but it was a garbage ass. It's a garbage whiskey that tastes like crap. It's too strong. It's like 100 proof shit, so it tastes like gasoline. I'm just drinking that with a little bit of ginger ale lemonade to water down the gasoline taste. Is anybody else drinking, or are we drinking alone tonight? I know my girlfriend's watching, and she is drinking a Stella Artois, I believe, if she's still drinking that beer while she works. I'm loading. Go back to the white wine. Cheap white wine. You drink the good stuff, but don't listen to me. Let's not get into that conversation again. I love you. I drank all day. I'm done for the night. Oh, Jesus, you're an alcoholic. Drank all day? Why were you drinking?
That's what I was trying to... That's what I was trying to set up earlier.
It's still loading. I feel like when we go the hour split, I'm going to restart my phone. Hopefully that fixes this, my issue.
Okay.
We'll keep riding it out. Social events. All right. Enough of you people. Let's talk about Avengers. All right,
do business.
Let's talk about the Avengers. Your phone is broken. Phone is not broken.
So, we were wrong on a couple things. We were wrong on a couple predictions there. But,
let's talk about that as the succession. I'm going to hammer through the whole fucking thing, and then we're going to go through it. Because I feel like we start at the beginning, we'll go through the whole thing, man.
Pound it out.
First and foremost, I basically just wrote notes on things that I liked. So we can go from there. Or points or whatever. Dear Mr. Fantasy, that's that opening song. Fantastic song choice. Was literally like about what was happening, and also just it's a nice like touch to the Guardians movies, but it's also was about like it's like a nice thing for Tony Stark, you know. If you go back and listen to that song and read the lyrics, it's very on the nose for the fucking movie, which is wild. These guys really thought of every single thing, like. Everything means something. There's no just empty shit. I will tell you the first time I shed human tears was the return scene of Tony Stark. Tony Stark returns on the Benatar with Captain Marvel. And he's walking down and he sees Pepper and he's all skinny and frail. I cried a little bit there, not a full, just a welling of tears, because that was a really great fucking scene. And then Rocket holding hands with Nebula, fantastic moments.
That was so pretty many, sweet.
So many great little fucking subtle moments. I really enjoyed the first half hour so much because it was still really bleak, really fucking bleak. Yeah. And Tony Stark showing up really fucking skinny and really frail and super fucked up and kind of crazed. I just thought
pissed about everything.
Yes. I cried when we showed Nebula how to have fun with Paperful. Another great scene.
That was a good scene.
That's a great scene because Nebula got to win and she's always lost with Gamora. They do little things like that in the movie. The characters get little things, and that was a little thing for her. She always lost, so she wins in that little scene. Great little moments. But that was the first time I welled up in the movie. Was when Tony returned, and it was like, and then that leads you into the fucking scene where he's all hooked up to the fucking IVs and shit, and he chews Cap out, and he starts yelling at him, and they recall their argument from Age of Ultron, which was a good argument, and neither of them are wrong. That's the thing about it. That's why it's so great. Iron Man wanting to fucking put everybody under the protection of a supercomputer made with robots is a bad idea, but also wanting to protect everybody with a bunch of super robots from aliens is a good idea. So it was like him kind of going, you said this, we would lose, and we lost, and it was like, and him yelling at him and saying all that shit when he was really skinny, oh man, that was a fucking scene. That was Robert Downey, he was shooting fucking threes right there, just like, whoosh, 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 acting so good.
The hardest selling he's done in a while.
Because as Tony Stark, he kind of walks through the role kind of as himself, just like, jokes, 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 sarcasm, jokes. But that, like, yeah. Those little moments, that's why I really enjoyed it so much, because it was so heavy-handed, and I wasn't expecting it to go that way. I wasn't expecting Tony to just come out and be like, fuck you.
Well, song cuts out, right? Like, I don't remember there being a whole lot of any kind of music or anything in there, so it was just, like, all their dialogue. in dead silence behind it. Like, it was, it was pretty awesome the way they did that shit. Like, I definitely felt the same way where you could see it on Captain America or Steve, where he was just like, he was happy to have Stark home.
Yes, but also,
but he knew he was going to have to defend himself. Like, he knew he was going to have to, like, still stand for what the fuck he stood for way back when. And still feel like it might have been wrong, but knowing that it wasn't for him.
It was wrong. I mean, the reason why they lost is because Cap is afraid to make sacrifice. They lost because they did not make sacrifices. He was like, his whole thing is like, we don't trade lives or whatever.
Right.
Like, you're going to lose, you'll lose. And Tony was right. We will lose. And they lost. But it all worked out, sort of, in the end.
Which I think is funny from Cap's perspective, where him being a military man, like, that's not a military ideal. Like, we don't trade lives. Like, the military, I mean, but, like...
Yeah, his well, we'll get to that later, because I want to come to that at the end, his kind of character arc, but he is, the thing about him and Tony is that they're so fucking stubborn that they are relentless in their, like, in their character flaws. Like, they just won't let anything... Nothing's gonna sink in. You can't convince Cap shit. You can't convince Tony shit. Like, they have to make those decisions on their own.
Well, they both have an idea of what a greater good is, and they're borderline the same page. It's just old-timey version of what that means in the technological definition of that, right. The greater good is where that trade-off is. And it's been fun to watch for this long. Civil War was really good about setting all that up and, like, really breaking them down at the end to, like you're saying, that whole fucking delivery from Stark to Captain America, where he basically throws down the gauntlet and is just like, dude, you fucking said this, and none of that fucking happened the way you said it was going to happen.
Yeah, he said you were fucking wrong. You said we would lose together, we lost together, and everyone's fucking dead. Like, he was just like, he didn't pull any punches, and he just, like, stuck knives. And Cap is Cap, so Cap didn't emotionally react. And that is why Captain America is great, because a normal person would get fucking right back in your face and be like, fuck you, like, this is the way it is, and blah, blah, blah.
Right.
Cap is just like, he takes it in. And that's why those characters are so good, and that's why all of these guys, everybody involved in these movies, did such a great job, because they really, they built something so fantastic and just something so real and tangible and immediately understandable with all of them. They're just like, I get why he does this. I get why he does this. And, like, you just know. Like, they're not going to budge on it. But, yeah, so that was, like, my first emotional scene. And then, basically, it's like, they go, oh, yeah, let's all just get on a fucking ship and go get him, you know? Which, you know, deep down, is, like, whatever's going to happen, it's not going to work that easy, you know?
See you, Tab.
Till next time, I'll click through this later. Interesting AF. And go to bed, Grandma. so they go there and they have that great shot, like, which they used a million times, of Thanos. I really like that Thanos shot of, like, him touching the wheat or whatever, the fucking alien wheat, which is definitely an homage to Gladiator, when he's like, Gladiator, like, Russell Crowe would have those dreams about after he was done, and he would, like, settle on a farm. Those are, like, subtle little homages to old films. I really liked that. And Thanos is a great villain because he is also very stubborn, but also a very easy-to-understand character. You understand his motives. They're not confusing, and they're not contradictory, you know? Like, you get it. You get why he does what he does, or why he wants what he wants. So when you go there and you see that he destroyed the stones, he's like, of course he did, because he's the ultimate thinker. He's the ultimate general. And, like, in Infinity War, he was so zen. He never got really that mad. So he had this shit planned and planned and planned. It was so perfect. And so when Thor chops his head off, spoiler!
What?
I know. Crazy. Chops his goddamn head off.
So even before that, when they figure out that, you know, there was the signature from when he used the stones on Earth, and then when he destroyed the stones, that's how they track him there. Mm-hmm. That whole thing where, like, Thor's just kind of, like, sitting off to the side, like, you can tell he's, like, really built up this, like...
And you know what he was doing in that book?
Like,
He's drinking craft beer and eating Hawaiian rolls. Did you notice that?
He sure is.
He was carb loading even at that moment. He's carb loading, which I love because it's so fucking
funny. He was upset. That is a funny fucking joke, though.
I'm just going to only eat bread.
And drink bread.
It's so amazing. We'll get to that shit later. But yeah, that's great, man. There's little things like that. He's just eating Hawaiian rolls. That's like my dream as like an inner fat kid to just be like, I'm going to eat fucking bread all day.
You know, it's funny, is my inner fat kid was a legit fat kid at one time, so...
Oh, yeah.
I would totally eat some Hawaiian bread.
I was definitely very fat. Shout out to me in 2003 to 2005. I was very fat. Then I went to L.A. and got very vain. Lost a bunch of weight.
I was just a fat kid, so...
You look great now, though. Sexy.
It's because I drink craft beer and eat Hawaiian rolls.
The one thing about that, what you mentioned about the signature that they caught, one theory about that stuff that's floating around, because that the stones, I guess, when they did the snap. The stones emit gamma radiation, which they revealed in multiple Avengers movies, which is why they hired Banner in the first place, first Avengers movie to come on, because the Tesseract was gamma, all the stones are gamma. And they think that,
which I did watch that. I did watch that before I went. Like, I think I ended up watching that on, like, the Thursday, or maybe it was that Friday before we went on Sunday.
The first Avengers?
Yeah, just because of the discussion we had had before that we'll get to later.
It's still the best one.
But yeah.
It's still good.
But yeah, so it was nice to have that like fresh take on it. Where
we watched Infinity
that's
War
why they got Banner.
That's it.
What's that?
I said we watched Infinity War the night before we went.
Awesome.
That's all I did. I didn't want to go too far back.
Dude, I've watched Infinity War probably like 5 or 6 times already, so I feel like that movie is just stuck in my craw. Like, I know that movie.
With the signature thing, a theory that's floating around the internet, I don't know if this will come to fruition at any point, but because every time someone does a snap, it's like a huge wave of radiation, gamma radiation across the whole planet, so... They were saying that that could be like a setup for mutants in future movies.
Really?
This triggers like a mutant reaction in all of humanity. Not to mention...
So it turns on everybody's powers?
Yeah. Well, it affects everyone. It's like a wave of gamma through the whole planet. And also... It snaps away people and brings them back. So it's like that's a whole effect on a whole body of people, you know, that are just like,
that makes a lot of sense, man.
Yeah, it would be a interesting way for them to bring X-Men in, but I also don't want like young X-Men, you know, I want like, I kind of want them to all be like 19 or 20, like already on the X-Men, like the way they do Spider-Man where he's like, we don't need to talk about the origins. I like the idea that they already exist. I don't want to get too much into X-Men or whatever because it's a whole can of worms, but I would like the team to already exist. I don't want to watch an origin movie. I can't sit through one. But anyways,
I think they've already fucking missed the boat on that sweet, sweet X-Men origin story where Beast isn't blue. He's just a big fucking dude that can grab shit with his hands and feet, and he's muscular. You know, fucking Angel's on the team. Fucking Jean Grey is Miss Marvel, and everybody and their brother fucking got a boner for her, and she doesn't know what to do with her powers. Like, that shit makes more sense to me. Like, no Wolverine, none of that horse shit. Like, I think that good come-together fucking story is already too far gone.
I think what they should do, which is completely off-subject, the assessment movie shit, but I think they should do one movie with the original five, and then the next movie should be the 70s introduction, which they did, which was with the ethnic introduction, which is Storm, Nightcrawler, Colossus, and Wolverine. They should have that as the second movie.
Was it Warpath that was part of that?
Yeah.
But yeah, that shit would be fucking awesome.
Yeah, that's how they should do it. And the third movie should just be about whatever with those characters. And if they want to add more, like you want to add the 90s characters.
Honestly, if they started on the second iteration of that where it was fucking like Nightcrawler and Colossus and Warpath, like if that's where they started, I'd be down for that. Like, give me that version. Where,
that's a safe bet.
Because then you have like the core team, like you have the core team already, and then you're introducing maybe like three or four extra characters on top of it, and you go from there, and then you can tell whatever fucking X-Men story you want after that.
Yeah, and hopefully every movie isn't about how Magneto is like struggling to be good and evil, and like Jesus Christ, every goddamn movie. He's bad. He's so bad. Oh, wait, he's good. The end.
Remember when he almost got killed by the Nazis because he was a Jew and then he's a mutant bad. And people still want to kill him, but he wants to kill people because they don't like mutants. And now
he's literally... Those fucking movies are like an endless loop of pain for me. They're just like... Michael Fassbender is like annoying and...
Like, dude, I do not like him as Magneto.
How do you not have self-identity at this point? How is your shit so back and forth? You're clearly a grown man. Figure it out. You either want to fucking help or you want to be bad.
Because it took him forever to get a goddamn fucking family at one point. And then when he so got dumb. His...
Ugh. All those movies are so dumb. Anyways, back to... derail on terrible, terrible, terrible X movies. We were at the farm, Avengers farm. They obviously, that was a cool scene, but you kind of feel it that it was a loss from the beginning. As soon as they get there, it's like a loss. You don't expect anything good to happen. But that's why that first part of the movie is so good for me, tone wise. I just feel like it was still like bleak and also great for character stuff. Then they do the 5-year jump.
He was straight up like waiting for them too, though. Like
he was waiting to die for sure. He was done.
Like the damage done to him, I thought was a nice thing, because that was like all pre. Oh, I destroyed them. Like I fucking got rid of them. Like they just showed him and his like arm's all fucked up, and it's like, why is his arm fucked up? And then he's, I got rid of him. Like, what the fuck, you think I'm going to hang on to him? I did what I was supposed to do with him. Like, the one thing I set out to do, I did. Fuck you. I got a farm now.
He has a farm, but he was also, like, he was farming and stuff. He was doing that life, but he felt to me like he was just waiting to die. Like, that was it. His existence at that point was meaningless because he set out to do what he wanted to do. He's very much a soldier.
His
in
destiny
that way,
is fucking
and,
fulfilled.
Well, in general.
What does he say about destiny in fucking Infinity Game?
He said, run from it, it still arrives.
Exactly.
Something like that.
and showed up, did they were going to do, because he was done.
So they get through that fucking scene, which was fine and great, and also was the beginning of Thor's downfall. But, like, they do the 5-year jump, and then they get back to Cap at that fucking, like, survivor group or whatever, of, like, military guys or whatever it is. And what was interesting about that, well, obviously, was I think it was Anthony Russo was the, he played the first, they kept talking about it. It's like, this is the first gay character in the MCU. And I was like, yeah, but not, I mean, they could have actually given a real superhero, make a superhero gay, but whatever, instead of just some bit role. But the thing about that scene was, like, Jim Starlin, who was a comic book writer who co-created Thanos and co-wrote the original Infinity War stuff. He was a co-creator of Thanos. He was in that scene, too, as the bald guy with the glasses.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. He had a guest... he had a guest fucking spot in that scene, the survivor scene or whatever. And then we have... After that, you know, some stuff happens, but then we go into the most ridiculous part of the movie, which is insane that this is how they wrote this, but literally Scott Lang, aka Ant-Man, comes back into the world because a rat walks across a circuit board and turns on a machine, and that's how he gets shot back out of the quantum realm.
That's not what I expected. That is definitely not what I expected.
Terrible fucking writing. That's terrible fucking writing. And also, like, they were just like, at that point, that's the cockiness that you could only dream of having. It's like, yeah, a rat did it. Who cares? Like, yeah, fuck it. These people are going to eat it up, you know? Who gives a shit? This is a mouse did it. And I remember in the theater, I was like, fucking rat just saved Ant-Man. I was like, that's how Ant-Man comes back. Oh, goddamn.
Dude, I turned and looked at Lynn after it did it and turned it back on. Like, are you fucking serious? And she wasn't looking at me. She was just watching away. But I looked at her like, what the fuck is going on?
That shit was wild. That rat saved the MCU. It saved Earth. Saved everyone. Now, that doesn't mean Tony
was. You know who that rat was? It was actually Mickey Mouse.
It was the rat from the end of... what is that fucking Scorsese movie? What was that movie? With DiCaprio.
What?
What's the God, why can't I think about it? Is it The Something? The DiCaprio Scorsese movie where he's undercover the whole time. With Jack Nicholson.
The Departure?
The Departed. The Departed. Remember at the end of The Departed, because it was all about, like, rats and stuff?
And oh, yeah.
That rat just, like, walk across, and everyone hated that because it was so on the nose. It was like, what are you fucking doing? Like, why is this... You're a great director. Why are you putting this on the nose dumb shit? I was like, that's the same rat. It's the rat from The Departed. He's back, hopping through movies, saving the day, teaching exposition. But that scene was so, that shit was so wild to me. Like, I couldn't fucking believe that that's how they were going to do it. And no one ever mentioned it again. It was just like a rat. He's like, how'd you get out of the thing? They're like, he never says.
Oh.
Oh, it magically popped back out at the end. So you need to know. My daughter's old now, and that's all you need to know.
I lost my beard.
Yeah, so God bless that rat. You know, God save that rat. I hope that rat has a good life. And Jesus Christ.
Well, he's living in a storage unit.
That rat saved the MCU. Doctor Strange had a vision in Infinity War of that rat walking across the van.
Let that sink in.
Jesus Christ, so ridiculous, but whatever, it's fine. Then we move into...
It definitely didn't stop the rest of that movie being fucking amazing.
No, it doesn't. There's a lot of little ridiculous things in that movie that are like that, but that one's the biggest one. And then we moved to Tony Stark, and the 5 years later, he's a farmer-ish. Or he's just like a, he's kind of like how the farmers are. Like, he's a new age, grows his own food kind of farmer, like a lot of people, like tech people are in the Bay here. They, like, grow their own fucking vegetables and shit. And he has a daughter.
He's a man of the earth.
Morgan. That stuff was all good. That was very emotional and nice, surprising. And for a while, I thought they were going to show Pepper Potts, which I thought was interesting. It was like they kept showing the daughter. They didn't show Pepper Potts. And they finally showed her on the couch. I was like, Jesus Christ, thank God. So if they were just not going to show her, I was like, that would be fucking weird if they never had her come in any scenes. But, yeah, that stuff was all great. And but you start to feel it at that moment. You go, okay, when is this going to get ripped away? Like, who's going
to... Yeah.
Because, like, you're adding a lot of extra emotional baggage for Tony. And you're
just But it was also a reason to return for the fight. Like, it was that deciding factor. Do I do it to lose the cool shit that I have, or do I do it to save the cool shit that I have?
Right. Like
it was that fine line that they had to fucking draw in the sand for him, and I thought it was pretty cool. I think it was. Yeah. It also, I think it brought him down to everybody else's level in a way where it was. He wasn't just, like, the playboy anymore. He wasn't, like, the guy, like, a bazillion dollars and nothing fucking matters.
Well, like, you remember at the end of Age of Ultron, he's standing there with Cap next to his car or whatever, and he's like, oh, maybe I'll take a play out of Barton's book and
right
build Pepper and I a farm. This movie really relies on a couple movies, one or three movies, really. It's obviously the first Avengers, it's Thor the Dark World of all movies, and then fucking Age of Ultron. Age of Ultron is so heavy in this movie because it's like motherfuckers are just like, they call back to it like a dozen times, things that are said, things that happen, his vision obviously of them all dead, the broken shield and the fucking Chitauri and shit.
Mm-hmm.
He had all that vision. So, yeah, that was great callback. And it just goes to show you like how fucking brilliant they were all planning this for like a million years, you know? It's like, it's wild. It's fucking wild. The next big thing I would like to talk about is Hipster Hawk. I'm calling him Hipster Hawk because he is technically 90s or early 90s Professor Hawk or whatever when Peter David did that run in the Hawk comics where they made him a smart. But he was like more of a hipster. He looked like a hipster to me. He looked like somebody who lived in Brooklyn, like in a very gentrified area in Brooklyn, or maybe here in the Bay, a gentrified area of Oakland or something.
He was wearing a cardigan.
Yeah, he had the little gray hair and the glasses.
They don't make cardigans that big.
They do if you're an Avenger. And he was also in really good spirits, despite everyone being fucking dead or half the
world being
dead. He was pretty chipper. Pretty fucking chipper.
I think they played it well where he was, like, happy with his decision. Like, he was happy with himself. That he was like, I don't know why I didn't think about this before, where we could just, like, do this together. Like, got the brains and the brawn together. Like, why didn't I do this before?
And I am playfully calling that Hawk Fuckboy Hawk because he looks like a fuckboy on, like, Tinder. He will like, you know, leave your messages on red and shit, and he's not going to fucking message you
back. If he was a Tinder Hawk, he would have had a fucking man bun.
I don't know. Maybe 3 years ago, man bun, but not now. I feel like he's really on the cutting edge of fashion right now. I wonder how much time we have left for the first hour because I really got to pee. I'm going to try to take a pee break if it cuts off. Sorry.
Okay.
I need to go. I'm going to turn this guy on. I don't know. This is not going to work.
It's fine. We got one. It's just me.
I know. No one's on, dickhead.
Show me your Night King.
I want him to be, like, in the frame, but he's, like, short.
Hold See, you're having the same problem I had.
And maybe figure it out, because I'm smart. I'm a smart adult man.
Bingo. Okay, I'm taking mine with me.
I have P2.
All right. I got it.
There he is. That's a cool figure, man.
R.I.P.
That is a cool figure. Well, since no one's on here, I'm just going to set my phone down and take a P2.
I hope you're all enjoying this. It's like riveting entertainment right now.
I think it'd be great if like 10 people just fucking popped in right now to watch this. Fuck, I gotta turn the light on out here. There we go. That one will do. So every time we do this, I always feel like I'm giving people motion sickness when I move around. I move around way more than he does. Oops. Mosquito already. Damn it. I didn't think I'd see one of them for another month or so.
Oh God, I'm back. So lonely without me.
Yep. I had a bite of pizza. And I took a pee myself.
Back. Damn, we're only like a halfway through Avengers. Shit. Oh. Hey, we're back.
That was perfectly timed.
Yeah, cut us off right at the right moment. And now we are back. I don't know what we're talking about. We're talking about Fuckboy Hawk. And we're back. There's so much Avengers to get through. We're like barely through this stupid movie. So much to talk about. Let's just get on with the fucking one of the best parts of the movie, the biggest surprise, which was Fat Thor.
Fat fucking Thor.
Fat what Thor was a surprise because nobody expected that. And
no.
They ride it out through the whole movie. You think in that kind of thing, they're like, oh, maybe he'll do something at some point and make himself skinny again. No.
That's what I thought.
They ride that shit the exactly whole what I thought. Thing. He's going to be a fat idiot the whole time. They completely stripped that character down. And I was so impressed. So impressed. I could
how much Fat Thor can you take?
All of it. give me a whole movie of him.
Exactly.
Fat Thor. Fat Thor the movie. I'm ready for it. And it was great because they go to New Asgard and they show that Valkyrie's alive. Korg and Meek are both alive.
Which was hilariously revealed.
Yes. Because, like, you
just
don't...
playing fucking video games.
Like, you don't get that at Infinity War. Because Infinity War is so serious and bleak, you don't get, like, any kind of nice little fun moments. So that was a fun moment. They go, oh yeah, by the way, these characters are all still alive, and they're very fun.
Dude, fucking Korg in the fucking Hawaiian shirt with like his shit ripped through it. It was pretty funny.
Just like, what's his face? He was basically wearing the shirt that, what the director, was his face? I can't pronounce his name. I'm not going to say it.
You better not. I don't know.
And, I don't even pronounce it wrong or I'll be a racist. Watiti?
So they did it wrong anyway.
I don't know how
to say his name either. I've heard it a thousand times.
And that's fucked up.
Say it wrong.
We are dumb Americans and we don't understand simple things. And I apologize for any of our international viewers. Any shout outs to anybody in New Zealand who might accidentally watch this on YouTube? I apologize. Fat Thor was the best part of the movie because it was the most unexpected part. You spend so much time thinking, what is this? Is this going to happen? Is this going to happen with Cap? Is Iron Man going to die? Yada yada yada. You're dissecting those things and you're already pre thinking about them. I was never like, I wonder if Thor is going to get really fat. Like, it's not a thing that's like that in your fucking brain. So that's why it was so brilliant and so
fun. You know how Thor's full of emotional baggage right now?
He's just going
to. That won't have any effect on him.
He's just going to eat his weight in fucking rolls and drink beer. It's amazing. Craft beer.
All kinds of craft beers.
That was great. That's top-notch shit, man. That's great. And that moves us on to, I guess, the Ronin stuff with Natasha going to Japan and finally, because they kind of clue that Hawkeye is like out doing stuff a couple times. And then she goes to basically get him and he has like a samurai fight with this Japanese drug lord or whatever he is.
I was bummed out on they didn't go full Ronin mask.
Yeah, I mean, I could have done without the whole thing. Like, it didn't really tell me much more that I needed to know that he was really hurting, that his family was dead. You could have literally just shown me, like, him sitting in a fucking empty house. And I
right.
was like, yeah, he's really fucking sad. Like, I didn't need him to
my be pull, out. My pull away from Hawkeye going into Ronin was... He couldn't sit still. Like, he couldn't just be okay with, okay, maybe he figured out, like, half of everybody's gone within the 5-year span. He figured out what was going on. And then him trying to maintain some sort of justice within that small group of people that were left.
Right. Yeah, that makes sense.
So is him, you know, stuck in hero mode, trying to do the right thing for the people that still remained?
Yeah, also it's like a self... It's like self-destruction, you know? I get it. Like, he had nothing to live for, so he's just like, I'm gonna...
Yeah, he was... He was out to
kill myself without actually killing myself, you know.
You just yeah, I can at least go out doing the right thing. I get it.
Vibrate.
Hang on a second. I just got a text message from my brother. Yeah.
It's a dick pic.
I wish. No, I missed it.
Check out my juicy hog.
I was just outside too. Fuck, I just missed them.
Who? Oh.
My brother and his wife are leaving.
Oh. Oh, look, Katie's on. Hey, Katie, how was your fucking night out?
Hello.
Okay, so we're done with Ronin. Then basically the movie turns into a time heist movie. It turns into a time traveling movie when Tony basically figures out time travel or whatever. He's like, oh, I did it. I figured it out. He has, like, that moment. He's like, I did it.
Yeah.
Whatever. And,
Like, his discussion with Pepper is just like, I mean, I could do it, but I don't know if I should.
I could reverse everything, but why? Yeah, so the movie basically turns into the time travel movie for an hour, which is great. Super fun. This is like the fun, I think the fun part of the movie, because it's also the time heist, but also it's the rebuild of the Avengers team, mm-hmm. because they were disbanded, you know, they were a disbanded group, a lot of conflicts. They bring back all the originals and they put them all on together and they're like, we're going to do a fucking team thing, which they haven't done since Age of Ultron, which was quite a few years ago. Doesn't seem like that long ago, but it was sometimes. And also this movie takes place 5 years plus, so it's that these characters are all realigning like a lot later after they had all been kind of disbanded, so that was really great. My favorite part of the time heist stuff is when they go back to the Battle of New York, which is something that I already knew was going to happen because of leaked photos or whatever, set photos,
and that's stuff that we had talked about before too.
Yes.
Like when we were talking about the trailer and stuff and how it seemed that that's exactly where they were going to go, because, well, we thought there'd be more interaction between Tony Stark and old Captain America.
Yeah, they did do that. They did CG his costume, but he was in, like, I was not expecting him. I thought they were going to CG the fact that he was going to run into old Cap, like that, mm-hmm. Downey was going to run, or Stark was going to run into Cap from 2012 or whatever the fuck that year was.
Right.
I thought that's why they CG'd it, but it was actually current Cap in the old costume. And then they went and CG'd the costume in the trailer to make you think that it was like that. So it was still the current Cap, but it was CG'd. So I was right to a degree. I was right that they CG'd that fucking...
Very CG'd. Marginal degree. Yeah.
I was right. Cool as fuck, though. I will always be right.
I thought that shit was smart as fuck. That whole go-through where they were in the Battle of fucking New York. Jesus Christ, that was so fucking good.
So fun. So much fun. And, like, the fact that they nonchalantly gave Tony a heart attack, like, oh, just give me a fucking heart attack. I'm like, okay. That could go wrong. And then fucking Loki grabs the fucking shit. That goes wrong, and he bounces out of there. So that means that Loki, who is dead in their timeline, according to their science, that Loki has now branched into a different timeline where he is still alive and will go on to do whatever. So guessing that's what the Disney show will be, is that Loki after he grabs the Tesseract and bounces? Because they go cool further idea. Back.
It's a cool idea.
So, like, Loki is technically alive in some other multiverse kind of situation. The other parts that were cool about that was Cap fighting Cap, him being annoyed with himself, you know?
That was pretty awesome. The Hail Hydra fucking...
Okay, the elevator scene was fucking great. Like, with fucking Frank Grillo and shit, and you think they're gonna redo the fucking Winter Soldier fight scene again. And then for him to whisper Hail Hydra, I was in the theater, and our theater cheered. They, like, screamed. They clapped and cheered. It was a great moment. I was like, that is fucking great.
Mine was dead silent.
Really?
Ew, God, it was fucking... You could hear a pin drop. Like, everybody was just, like...
There were only two moments. It was that moment, and then when Doctor Strange showed up in the big battle towards the end.
Yeah. Okay. Actually, I should say our theater was silent in that moment when he said Hail Hydra, except for me, and I went, hoo-hoo! Like an idiot.
that's the perfect time to make that noise. That was such a great... And that goes back to everything. Everything is like a wink and a nod to all the old movies. So much of it is just like...
And the comic shit, man.
Remember this, remember this, remember this, remember this. And it's like, yeah.
Well, like the whole comic thing, too, where they did that, oh, fucking Captain America was part of Hydra and all that bullshit. Like, yeah,
that was dumb.
Exactly. And that's how they kind of... Maybe it was neat, but it's still not neat. That moment was neat.
Yeah.
But,
I also liked, I even liked the stuff with Tilda Swinton.
The
stuff with Tilda Swinton when they go, where she's like...
Oh, yeah, and she's talking to Hulk and shit. That was awesome.
And, you know, Doctor Strange is not Doctor Strange yet. And that stuff was good. And you got to see Mark Ruffalo, like, actually as Mark Ruffalo for a brief moment in the movie, which was cool.
I thought that whole thing was really neat, that that callback to Doctor Strange where she knocked him out of the Hulk. So she didn't have to deal with the Hulk, because you could tell she was kind of intimidated by the fucking Hulk to a certain degree.
I like all the New York stuff so much, because it's like they brought back fucking Robert Redford as Pierce. Those are scenes you never saw in the first Avengers movie. Like, you're almost watching, like, behind the scenes shit of, like, a fucking movie. Them bouncing around. It is. They make fun of Back to the Future, but that shit is all Back to the Future Part 2, where they're sneaking around their old selves and stuff. It's the same fucking thing. They're like, this movie's stupid. They do time travel wrong. Anyways, this movie's just like that.
And I like how they went through that, like, whole rigmarole of, like, you can't interact with your fucking self.
Yeah.
You can't do that. And Captain America is the one that has to fucking kick his own ass.
Yeah, that was the start. That little moment where he, like, admired his own ass, that was the start where you kind of go, which leads to
that was pretty funny. Movie
where you go, Cap has had an actual growth change as a character, because that's something he wouldn't have said previously.
Exactly.
Just reacted. Then that really plays out towards the end, which we'll get to when we get towards the end of the movie.
That moment put him more in our time than ever.
It just became like he's not as stuffy, you know? He's not as stuffy Boy Scout or whatever. All of that, and I like the stuff with Howard Stark, but I felt that those scenes kind of ran kind of long for me. I get the why they did it, because they're doing a full circle of Tony Stark's character arc, and he has daddy issues. Right. And that was like they had to, like, kind of address his daddy issues and end them. And mm-hmm. that did it in that scene, which I enjoyed it, but not my favorite part of the movie. Cause
it was definitely a putting to bed of a lot of, like you say, everything they had touched on before. But I think it was also an insight to what he didn't want to do to Morgan.
Yes.
That whole thing that he was trying to avoid, being a father, which is, fuck, man. I mean, me being a father, those are things you fucking worry about. Those are legit fears that you have having a child. My dad was always there. I mean, he's still here. He's probably one of the best dudes on the fucking planet. But it's a legit fear. You're afraid of those things. You're afraid of, what am I doing to my kid?
Yeah.
But, like, to hear Howard's, like, version of it, of, like, well, I got to do these things for everybody. And it's like, I just, you know, to know where he wanted to be. I think that shit was super cool. To know that he was actually, like, upset with the fact that he wasn't there and shit like that. That was pretty rad. So.
Yeah, I liked it, and it, again, that had the fucking Ant-Man helmet, you know, the Ant-Man.
Oh, yeah.
Old school Ant-Man helmet was in the fucking lab or whatever. Pim's.
See, that's where Lynn went to the bathroom, and I thought she had missed all of that. So when she came back up, I was trying to, like, speed deal her into what had just happened.
Uh-huh.
And I got to the helmet thing. She's like, I know, I saw it when I came in. Whoa! Pump the brakes, bruh. Didn't know you saw that.
Yeah, that was a good little Easter egg for sure.
I loved how chintzy and shitty it looked. Like, it literally looked like it was made out of foil.
It looks like some cosplay shit.
I'll tell somebody banged it out real fast.
I'll tell you one thing that's really amazing about the movie is that the fucking, you know, when they all have their quantum suits on, mm-hmm. they're about to jump or whatever, they all have, like, they all put their fists in. It's like a circle. It's red. Mm-hmm. They all have the red shit on there. That is the exact fucking arc reactor. Tony's first thing that says, proof that Tony Stark has a heart, is like all those little red things in a circle. That's exactly why they did it. Yeah, go look at that. Go Google that image. It's that fucking thing. It's
holy the same thing. Shit.
It's like the same number of fists. It's all in a circle. And then they obviously show that again later during his funeral. But, like,
yeah.
That's like proof of Tony. That's like they literally made the arc reactor with their fists. It's crazy.
Damn it.
Yeah, damn it. That's how much they fucking thought about this shit and how long they've been thinking about it.
I might go watch it again in the morning.
I'm gonna try to see it next week. Let me see what else we got here. Okay, now we have to talk about the one thing that I was kind of meh over that my mom actually saw the movie today, which I talked to her, which was great. I'm sad I didn't get to see it with her. I saw the last two movies with her, but we didn't get to see this one with her. She saw it today. Which is the Soul Stone mission with Hawkeye and Black Widow. Which is a rough one, but I also, like...
Dude, that was pretty fucking good scene.
I was not, like, sad about it. And I know that's fucked up, but I was not sad about it. I just wasn't... You know, there are things that trigger me emotionally, and when it comes to writing self-sacrifice kind of stuff, where a character kills themselves...
See, I think the that's spin not, they did on that, though, where it was both of them wanted to be the one.
Right, but we all knew it was not going to be Hawkeye because he has kids. Like, he has kids, so they were going to come back. So I knew it was never going to be him. It was never going to be Hawkeye. I knew it was her from the get-go.
Yeah, but he just seems more expendable.
No, because they already took so much from him. If they were like to kill him on top of it, it would be weird writing. It's just like from a writing standpoint, I go, it's like a zombie movie when somebody's like, go, I'll hold the blood, I'll stay here and I'll blah, blah, blah while you run away. And I'm just like, oh God, this is how you get rid of characters because you're a bad writer. Like, this to me, it's like, I get why they did it. And Scarlett Johansson probably wants to be done with the fucking movies. I guarantee that she wants out.
Yeah, I
mean, a decade of doing this shit on repeat is probably annoying. Annoying in the sense that you're really rich, but like you're also tired of doing the same thing over and over. It's like any other job, you know, you're doing it for 10 years. You want to get something else. She wants to do other roles. So it was good. My mom, I mean, it worked on my mom. My mom said she cried during that scene. I did not get that emotional over it. I thought it was good. And it made sense. But it was also, to me, not my favorite part or a part where I was like, oh, yeah.
I'll say I got emotional about it, but I think it was because I was already so emotionally invested into everything else that had already happened.
I guess I was just...
to where...
I mean, like, in fast-forward mode where I was just like, let's get to the big, let's get to the end. Like, I don't care about this middle shit. Like, yeah.
You and I definitely watched... You and I definitely watch movies differently.
I was like, kill both these idiots. Like, I was just like, kill both of these worthless dipshits and they're fucking... Hey, an intergalactic god. Pew, 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 pew. I got an arrow. Pew, 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 pew. I'm just like, kill both these dipshits. Like, can we just be done with this? Like, these dipshits with fucking...
Dude, I still like think that Saturday Night Live skit that when he was on Saturday Night Live, he's like, well, I'm out of arrows. They're like, what? Like, how many did you bring? He's like, you know, all of them. 11?
And, that's the brilliance also back to Age of Ultron of Joss Whedon's writing, because Joss Whedon is so good about writing funny character stuff. When he said that stuff to Scarlet Witch, he was like trying to pep talk her in that battle scene. He was like, this is blah blah. He's like, I'm shooting a bow and arrow. None of this makes any sense. Like, you know, like, that's great fucking writing where you kind of go, it is stupid that you have a bow and arrow. It is dumb. Like, you know?
100%.
So, like, at the end of that, like, if either of them died, I was like, fine. Because they're not helpful.
Honestly, the inclusion of Hawkeye through all of it has escaped. Like, the necessity for that.
They do it because they have to have, like, a human element. Like, someone that keeps them grounded as, like, these are, like, you have to have a humanity part.
Dude, I get it, but don't you think that Black Widow would have just been enough?
I mean, Hawkeye is really popular. If Jim was on, he could talk about it. Like, there are a lot of people who like Hawkeye a lot. I'm not a big Avengers comic reader. Hey, Tim, what up? I get why they did all of it and it works, but I wouldn't have been sad if both of them died. Like, it was not like a big date. Tim, by the way, we're talking about Avengers, so if you haven't seen it, you should bounce out.
He saw it. He and I talked about it earlier.
Okay. But that was like, I mean, that was a big scene. That was like, they killed a core member of the team, so it was a big deal. That was the original six. I'm at the bar still. I got a bar at my house.
We haven't even got to Game of Thrones yet, so I don't know if I'll make it up, but I hope we can hang out. Help. Kid, you're on your own. Help if yourself, Len ain't home, yourself. I can't leave because Vivian's asleep a room over.
Help yourself and just leave. You're an adult. Open the door and walk out.
ghost that place like you ghost everywhere else.
It's just so simple. Just be like, hey, I go to the bathroom and then never come back.
Anyways. All right, so where were we?
We're done with Soulstone, and then basically it goes, they get all the stones, and then they build the Stark.
Oh, no, we got to go to... the Power Stone.
Morag.
Yeah.
Yeah, that scene was like, that's how they set up the thing with Thanos and shit about like Nebula's network was like crossing over with her old self or whatever. That's all stuff. And it was funny with the Peter Quill thing. It was like he's a douchebag or whatever.
Right.
Because they were just watching him sing without the music.
That's pretty great.
Funny.
That was a funny joke.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
But what I like about that, though, too, was, like, how do you make it so they can't just get away with, like, grabbing all the fucking stones?
Well, there had to have been, there had to have been a speed bump at some point. Perfect
fucking catalyst for that, to where it's such a cool fucking idea, to where Thanos's fucking disgusting behavior, where he treats his daughter like shit, fucking helps him, but it also bites him in the ass. I thought that was really fucking cool, where it's like, I've made all these modifications to her, I want her to be better, I want her to be this, I want her to be this, and it lends him that insight into what's actually going on, right. But then it also fucks him over to where she knows he knows, and fuck, it's god damn it.
Yeah, it's
fucking things that become so gigantic are just...
There had to have been, like, a setup for Thanos to kind of have, like, a comeback moment, and that was it. And I was waiting for it, and that was...
I don't know what else they would have done, though.
I mean, he's really fucking smart, so... He was close. He almost did it again. That's why he's formidable.
No, but I'm saying, like, how else would he have figured it out? If they hadn't used Nebula as that catalyst...
I don't know. Because it's like you're at the...
Who the fuck knocked on my door? Why didn't you answer the damn door, Courtney? Everyone. I didn't hear the door.
He's already gone.
I did not hear the door.
He's already ghosted on this conversation. Cool. So yeah, so that happens at Thanos, yada yada yada, that shit. And then basically they have all the stones. They get all the stones. They retrieve them all. It seems very simple.
They all come back without fucking Scarlet Witch, and they lose their shit for a second.
Black Widow.
Oh, we didn't even... Yeah. I said the wrong thing. We didn't even talk about Thor and fucking Rocket going to get the fucking ether.
Okay, we can talk about that. The wildest thing about that Endgame is how prominent and how important they make Thor 2 Dark World, which is like everyone's favorite fucking MCU movie other than Iron Man 2.
I actually like that one.
It's like fucking like, it's boring. It's so boring. I like that one. So boring.
I like it.
And then they're just like, and what was wild about that is, like, Renee Russo, who plays Thor's mom, actually has more lines in Endgame than she had in fucking Dark World.
She, in any fucking, all the Thor movies together.
Well, if I'm going to come back and do this, I'm going to say at least 10 things. Like, you know, I'm not going to fucking just put this outfit on for no reason.
Fucking Thor movies put together, she says more in fucking Endgame.
Yeah. And it was good. It was great for Thor. That was a great Thor character scene. And the stuff with Rocket was really funny when, you know, he was just still trying to drink. He was trying to drink that stuff that he was drinking in Age of Ultron, which he gave to Stan Lee that made him keel over.
Even the little things in that shit where she knew that he wasn't him from that time.
Yeah.
One, he was fat as fuck. But two, like, his eyeballs.
And he had fingerless gloves. That's how you should know right away that Thor is not of sorts. Why is Thor wearing fingerless gloves everywhere? Like, that's how you... Oh, is that, like, what you do when you get fat? Is that a fat thing? When I was fat, I didn't wear fingerless gloves.
He couldn't invest in a koozie. He didn't want his hands to be cold when he drank a beer.
Just, like, fucking fingerless gloves in every scene. I was like, even in the end, he had he shot himself down, got a costume, was like, fingerless gloves still.
Pushing the hobo agenda.
It was very fucking Skid Row of him.
It was awesome. It was super cool. Yeah, we don't have to hang out on that one, but what's her nuts?
Natalie Portman?
Yeah.
I thought that was stock footage. I don't think she did go to the premiere, but I don't think she filmed any extra scenes. I think that was extra footage they had from Dark World. Because they don't actually show Rocket fucking get out of her.
No, so that makes sense.
I don't think they shot anything.
But they could have even done that on like a stand-in or something. You know what I mean? Like they could have done that on like a stunt person. But the fact that like you would have stabbed that into her and she probably would have made a face or whatever.
I heard some kind of reaction. She also tough character, and like she probably wouldn't have just like accepted it, you know. She probably would have had some fight. So the way around that is just don't fucking shoot a real scene with that. So just like do it off screen.
Yeah.
Have Rocket, you know, just be funny or whatever in that moment.
That was pretty funny.
Yeah, so that
I did like Rocket a lot in this movie.
Oh, I love Rocket. Rocket is my
everything favorite. With Rocket in this movie was fucking super awesome.
Rocket is king. Rocket is king of the Avengers.
With Infinity War, there's some Rocket stuff that makes me super emotional.
Yeah, especially when James Gunn revealed that when Groot dies, he's actually saying dad.
Yeah, fuck that shit. That made my heart hurt so bad.
I was like, why would you reveal that? Like, that's like trolling. That's trolling. Like, there's no way that's true. He just said it later to hurt people.
Yeah.
But that leads back to later when they have when the Avengers headquarters gets blasted up, and they're during that battle sequence. Rocket protects Groot when Groot comes back. You know, he's hiding him. He protects him because he can't live to see him die a third time.
Yeah. But holy shit, dude. When fucking Thanos comes, like, everything's fucking coming to a fucking head, and Thanos comes and destroys fucking the Avengers facility. That shit is just fucking bananas. Just straight fuck. And then you got fucking Rocket down in the bottom of that shit, and everything's fucking piled on, and fucking the Hulk's trying to fucking like lift everything up, and Rocket just saying, "I can't breathe."
That was rough.
Like, like even now, like that shit fucking freaks me the fuck out because yeah, I'm super claustrophobic and shit. But
phobic as fuck. It was really good at them going like, "Oh yeah, let's just keep fucking with everyone's heart." But before the walls caved in,
there's definitely all that beforehand. Yes,
we didn't talk about the fact that Hawk.
They got all the stones, so all the stones are there.
Yeah, Hawk. That's how Hawk does a successful snap and does bring everyone back, but it takes a while for them to all show
up. And it also fucks him up, which I didn't think it. Honestly, I didn't think it was going to do that.
Well, Hawk doesn't really play by the same rules as the comics because. Like, for example, when he fights Thanos in Infinity War, like a one-on-one boxing match, the thing about Hulk is, like, the more you pummel him is that he should just get stronger and stronger and stronger. Like, he should get bigger and stronger. And he more...
But that also equates to Thanos having the Power Stone at that time.
Yes. Who is Hulk? His name is Hulk. Joe Russo. Shout out Joe Russo, co-director of Avengers Endgame.
Hey, I think Timmy's gonna come on with us here for a second.
Oh God,
he's outside my house.
Throw a rock at him.
I'm gonna hit this bitch all around.
You're welcome. Thank you, Joe.
He's a liar.
We're still working through. We're almost into the third act of Avengers Endgame. It's a very long movie to talk about.
I think Tim is a liar.
He said, I'm walking down the alley.
Oh, then he's on his way. I hear him. He's coming.
Thank God. Because I was like, oh God, what are we going to do unless Tim shows up?
What's up, dude? Why are you rattling? Is that your gum?
It's my gums. I gotta pee.
Yeah, third act. We're at Hulk's name.
Yeah, we're at Hulk post snap. Timmy.
Don't Z your own movie, dipshit. He's directed it. You should be happy that it turned out so well. Where's
Tim? Is he referring to his horror movie?
No, he's referring to Avengers Endgame, which he co-directed with his brother Anthony.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, congratulations, dude. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks for joining us and making $1 billion.
Super proud of you.
Spending money, yeah. I would too. I would fucking actually do that if I was that director. I would literally.
Right?
I would throw $100.
I don't care how uncomfortable that shit would be. I would sleep on a pile of money if I had it.
Where's Tim?
I would not put that in a bank. He's right here.
I don't see him. He's out of frame. Get the frame, you call it. Get the frame.
All right, here we are. Me and
hey,
Timmy.
Hey, it's Lenny. Hey. What's up, guy?
Not much.
Your face is mostly hidden by words.
I ghosted from the bar to be here.
Good job.
Didn't tell anybody I was leaving.
That's what we were hoping for.
That's exactly what I said to do.
Yeah. I whispered to Holly, I said, give me the house key. She had her keys on her. And then I'm like halfway here, and I'm like, oh yeah, they're doing this. I'm going to stop on the way home. It's on my way home, so.
Yeah.
Here we are.
But I was listening to your guys' Endgame.
We're still there?
Yeah, it's, yeah. It's almost as going as long as the actual movie itself.
Yes.
Yeah.
We're on the ball, post-snap.
Yeah, okay.
That's where we are right now.
Yeah. And we have Joe Russo on, who is the co-director of the movie. So if you want to say anything to him, he's asked many questions. He's okay. Here.
Sweet.
Yeah. We are at the Hulk snap. I think that's where we left off. What I want to talk about that post Hulk snap is basically like the battle shit, right? And then you're just like in a fucking like world of just like CG and fighting, which is all amazing. Yes, I am. I Infinity War. Infinity War Thanos is like so fucking zen, and I love Infinity War Thanos versus younger, I guess younger Thanos in this, where he's more warmongery still, wearing his armor and a little more brash to fucking like just like.
Well, think about it. Think about all of that where he doesn't have the same time that they have to think about all the things that he's thought about. From those 2 points, from getting the first stone to his snap, where he's built all of this in his head, like, I know exactly what I'm doing.
Like,
yeah.
He finds out what they're doing, so he's got to, like, hurry the fuck up and come up with a plan.
He also swaps ideologies really fast. He's like, oh, well, that didn't work. Erasing half the fucking population? I'm just going to kill everyone this time.
Yeah.
That's actually what the comics are like. That was what he was doing in the comics, was he was going to wipe out all life, you know, instead of half. But I actually like the half thing more. I just like the zen. Because, like, Infinity War Thanos had like all these great lines where he was just like hammering out fucking fortune cookie shit. Like, just like somebody would open a fortune cookie and be like, yeah, blah, blah, blah. And you'd be like, oh, fuck, you're right. Yeah. Like, if you were really stoned, you'd be like, yeah, Thanos. And like, but like, in this one, he's just like, well, fuck you. I'll just kill all of you this time, then, you dicks. Yeah. Like, you know, it's just like, but I get it, because it's just basically at this point the movie is just eye candy and just like jerk off love letter Marvel shit. Like, you're just a point. You're just at this point. You go, okay, well, all the cards are off the table. There's no story for like a half hour. It's just gonna be like, look at that. 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 Holy fuck!
You know what they didn't do? And I'm pissed at the non-director Joe Russo. For not putting it in, was Thanos' fucking helichopper that said Thanos on the tail of it. How else am I supposed to know it's his helicopter?
I don't know
if it doesn't say his name on it. You've never seen fucking Thanos' helicopter from the comic books?
Yeah.
It's the most ridiculous.
We'll get to the A-Force
fucking thing on the planet.
I've never seen that, no. Is that a comic book?
Yeah. That's great. Yeah, Thanos, like, and that was a lot of the teaser stuff, like, before was, like, people were, like, I hope we get to see that. You know, I hope we get to see that chapter. It's going to be the director's cut.
It was literally Thanos had a fucking helicopter that said Thanos on it.
Thanos on it, yeah. It would have been the cheesiest thing ever if they
put that in. Spider-Man has a car and shit, you know.
Yeah. But that's Spider-Man. He's a teenager.
He can't even drive legally.
Exactly. But he's got a goddamn sweet car.
So,
Thanos has a pilot's license.
I feel like the rest of the movie, the battle stuff, we can kind of just kind of burn through really quick. It's there's obviously like two big moments. It's basically Fat Thor lightning bolts himself into a braided beard.
Oh. That's where I thought he was going to be skinny Thor again, like muscular Thor again. Like that's what I thought was going to happen.
Beard.
And I'm so glad it didn't. It's just like, oh, my shit got braided and I got my suit on. I'm ready.
So he gets his another fight with Thanos and basically gets beat up again, which is wild. And then like he almost gets Stormbreaker shoved into his chest, which is obviously a throwback to Infinity War we don't really need to mention, but I just mentioned it anyways. And it's irritating because I was like, why can't Thor just beat the shit out of him now? But like whatever. And then it did, but it was just lead up to Cap getting Mjolnir or whatever. So yep. They could have that scene, which was great. That's comic book like jerk off material. They're just like, hey, do you like
but it
this?
Also
look at it. Just oh,
but it also nerves. Puts Thor back in that spot where he's not 100%. Like he's still he might be holding back a little bit.
The
like,
funniest he's part just, about it was
he spent that entire movie goes, being a fat turd.
But it's the funniest part about it, he's like Cap gets the hammer, and then he goes, I knew it! And then Cap starts fighting Thanos, and then Thor just, like, just sits there.
Yeah, he like, yeah. What's he doing? What's he doing in that time?
He's like, I'm gonna watch. I'm just gonna sit there.
Yeah, yeah. Like, put some fucking effort in, dude. Like,
nah, the dude abides. He's just gonna watch it fucking go down.
Remember when Captain Marvel was awkwardly forced in this movie? I remember the movie. Do you remember when you wrote and directed all of these scenes? You should remember it. Not my job. That's
and somehow you managed both haircuts for her?
That's the case for so many characters in this movie that weren't the original six, because there are 75 characters. So some of them are going to have awkward intros.
Well, and that's the thing. She, like, doesn't have time. She doesn't have time for Earth because of all the other planets.
Well played,
but she has enough time to get a fucking haircut.
Mm-hmm.
Come on. You know. Haircuts, what? That's probably about an hour's worth of her time. She could save Earth in probably an hour's worth of her time.
They have binaried.
Binaried her own hair. Like, yeah, yeah. Like, oh, yeah.
She just punched it off her head.
I want a bowl cut. Think about it. Okay, it's there.
Yeah, of course. That's corny. That's corny fucking movie writing, because it's just she.
Hey, you remember that time when a fucking rat turned on Ant-Man's gene?
Yeah.
So I guess
those
at this point, fucking,
slim to fucking none.
I guess at this point, her haircut is a mute point.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say also, Joe, your points are also mute because that accounts for literally so many other things. Like, you could be like, oh, he chopped him with the hammer. Why didn't he do this? Why didn't he do that? Why didn't they do this? It's because there are that half hour is just it's just superhero moments. Look at this. Like, watch this guy do this. Watch this person do this. Watch this. There's no logic behind any of it. That's the whole thing. It's just eye candy and jerk off material for nerds. And that's
they
why
knew at that point everybody was going to be excited for everything that was happening on the fucking screen, that nobody was going to give a shit about any of that stuff until way after it had happened.
Yeah, like, I don't think they're, like, overanalyzing any of that at that point. I mean, you can't really, this movie's not a real movie. It's not a real movie. It's not, it shouldn't be held to the same standards. It's literally just fan service for 3 hours.
Yes.
Yeah. It's 100 movies in one movie.
You're being dramatic right now, Joe. If you were on live, I would tell you that too. But you're being dramatic because it's just as corny as the first act is great because it's like a lingering bleakness of the Infinity War. But the second act is fucking corny too, man. It's wild corny. It's all corny and nonsensical.
It's all stone play.
It's just fucking ridiculous.
It was all so. Let's get this. Let's do like, stones.
I love it for exactly that. I'm not gonna fucking tear it down because little things don't make sense here and there. Oh, you're trying to get a triggered meme.
Yeah.
Okay, so fuck, I had something.
So for stage four, or whatever it is, the next stage.
We're not there yet. Don't talk about it.
Okay.
Yeah, we got to get to the end of this, real Martha. Fuck off, Joe.
The defining shot was at that moment, Cap fighting Thanos one-on-one for some reason, because Thor was just like, you just do this. I'll just lay here for this entire time. That Cap was standing there for a very long time.
No, it all goes back to that fucking first fight with fucking Thanos. He doesn't think he can do it. That shit made sense to me.
I think it's just cool shots. They just did it because they want Cap to be the solo thing in this moment where the army shows up so they can have the Sam Wilson.
Thor's got ED when it comes to fighting fucking Thanos. There's just no fucking boner.
Does Professor Hulk have that though? You know what I mean? Because I don't know. Like, Hulk has PTSD, but, like, does Professor Hulk have PTSD?
No.
Right.
Because he's two guys in one.
I think Hulk at this point has, cured himself. I think at this point he's happy and he is zen. I think he's zened out, which I find kind of annoying as for the character, but that's what they're going with in this movie. Right. But it's basically they set up the shot of Cap standing there facing off with Thanos and the entire army rolling through or whatever.
Yeah.
In this I guess a part of upstate New York. Where is Avengers thing? Seemed like a really big space. They shot it with missiles and then all of a sudden it was 40 miles of just
It was like a desert. And
where's all this space? Good thing they put the fucking base there. Yeah, upstate New York is there's just nothing, nothing there, and they show up with spaceships. If only Thanos would have just sent all of his spaceships to the rest of the planet, and he could have destroyed everything. But whatever.
It's true. Yeah.
He's like, I'll send all these ships and all these people to anywhere but here, and just kill everyone except for these 17 dipshits.
Right.
Outfits. But it's all about that shot, and then it's all about Sam Wilson saying on your left, and then they all show up through fucking Doctor Strange's sparklers, and it's all eye candy, man. At that point, it's just eye candy. And yes, the A-Force shot of the women heroes is super fucking forced and awkward, but I still like it because at this point, it's just look at this. Look at these things that you know that you like. This movie's not like a normal movie, and it wasn't from the beginning, and it doesn't feel like it. So, the A-Force stuff is forced, and the female characters do take a backseat through the whole goddamn movie, so to have them show up, especially Shuri, and not have one line of dialogue, I was happy that she didn't say one fucking thing. I was like, Jesus Christ, can't even have her say something. But they had to do that. And that's the thing. It's fan service. They're like, oh, we got to please this person. We got to do this. And so I was like, here, what if all the ladies just lined up for some reason?
And it's the way that it was laid out, too, where it was just like the pan across.
They had never, most of those characters had never spoken words to each other. You know, let's all line up in a line, girls. But that being said,
the men needed to talk.
That being said, the Scarlet Witch throwdown with Thanos was great because I remember telling Rosina before, I was like, Scarlet Witch is really fucking strong. I was like, they don't even address how fucking powerful she is. obviously in the comics her powers are different, but
She was strong enough to destroy a fucking stone.
And that's the thing, too, with her and, her and Vision showdown in Age of Ultron. She, throws Vision, halfway through the fucking Earth. She couldn't do that, once with Thanos. You know what I mean? She has that ability, you know what I mean, where she can do whatever the hell she wants.
She did beat his ass for a couple, solid minutes. They did show
shoot his fucking space, just like, nah, you just go into space.
Well,
she could rip him apart.
Which will bring mutants into the world? I don't think so.
No, Joe, we already talked about it earlier. It's the gamma.
Or Ant-Man. Ant-Man can crawl up Thanos' ass and expand. He can do that at any time. Like, crawl, or his ear. It doesn't even have to be his asshole. It could be his ear, his mouth, nostril.
It'd be cool if it was his asshole.
It could be any of those, and he could end that. He could have.
The X-Men ride-around could be the fact that, like, the Thanos or the stone snap was an enormous amount of radiation on the Earth.
Yeah.
And not only happened once, but twice. So it affected everybody on Earth, plus the people who were snapped and then unsnapped. So you could create the fucking story that that fucking gamma radiation from the stones created mutants. I hope they don't do that, but that could be a way that they do it.
I'm not going to be mad if they do.
Yeah.
That's not going to bother me.
But I liked the on your left with Sam Wilson. That's it. Like I said, it's all fan service. It's nice. It's just nice Easter eggs and candy for you. Like, I liked it. Everybody comes back. Obviously, seeing Black Panther, great. Shuri is the best. Great. Pepper Potts in the armor, fine. Then you get the Avengers Assemble line, the yell, which you never got to hear in any of the movies. Fantastic. I don't know if you noticed, but Howard the Duck was in this shit.
Yeah.
I did not notice.
He came out of one of
he was in there.
Yeah.
So, like, Howard the Duck got a fucking entrance walk-on for that big battle, which is ridiculous.
I did not see that. I feel so dumb now.
Yeah. So my favorite part of that stuff was, like, the Scarlet Witch stuff. Rocket covering Groot in that battle scene, so he would, like, hide him because he couldn't see him. The A4 stuff was, like, a forced thing, but, like, I still liked it because I just like seeing the characters. I don't care. You had the one finger of Doctor Strange when he looked at Tony Stark. He was, like, the quivering finger. He's like, this is it. You have to die. And he, like, they gave each other that look, and he's just like, this is it. This is the vision, blah, blah, blah. And that was great. And also, Doctor Strange is the strongest Avenger and the most powerful. There's no other one who can do what he can do. He can actually fight Thanos with stones one-on-one pretty well. And he can fucking teleport whole armies.
Yeah.
He's really fucking strong. He can do all kinds of wild shit. So, like, he's the best Avenger in the end.
Yeah.
And then Iron Man uses the nanotech to steal the gauntlet, and then he gets a snap, and then he dies. And that's the fucking movie, pretty much. I liked the part I liked about that is that Thanos sat down once he knew he lost, you know?
Yeah.
That shit was cool as fuck.
He sat down because Thanos is such a cool villain, and they also treat him with such respect where he was just like, he sat down, when he won in Infinity War at the end, you know, he rested and then he sat down when he lost. He's just like, he's very, like, comfortable with himself in that way where he's just like, that's it. And I like that he sat down and then got dusted. I really like that. And then I obviously cried during the, not so much the death of Iron Man scene, but the funeral stuff. I think once it was like, I got through the Peter Parker hug and shit.
I did not.
Because, like, what sucked about that was, like, what I got out of Tony Stark was that he didn't even, like, he was so fucked from that snap. Like, he didn't even really recognize Peter Parker.
Yeah, that's what... Yeah.
You know what I mean? And the only person he really, like, recognized was Pepper when she came up. You know, he kind of gives that, like, hey, Pep. That's, like, the only thing he could utter because he was so fucked from that snap. Like, he was, like, his brain was destroyed, like, when he snapped it. Like, and that was the sad part, was, like, not him, not, like, even, I mean, he recognized Peter Parker, but, like, he was so destroyed from that snap. Like, there was no.
I think they did a really good job of really pushing that, where like his eyes were just kind of like rolling around.
Yeah, in his he was done. Head, he was dead.
Where he was dead already. Trying his hardest to fucking stay alive.
Yep.
But yeah, definitely like right after him and Peter talked, and then he started talking to Pepper. Yeah. He's just like, right. Oh, yeah. Fuck.
Yep. That was my oh fuck part. Like,
Blackwing didn't get a funeral because she was an assassin, and assassins don't get funerals. At least not fancy ones where a bunch of people come.
Exactly.
Yeah.
She was a classified like secret agent. I don't think they.
Really well, she was a lady, and we're talking about Tony Stark, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
One thing I learned later was like I'm sure you guys were confused too when they did the aerial shot of like everyone at the funeral, then they showed that singular like teenager kid.
And that was the kid from Iron Man 3.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like I didn't know that until like after the movie. I was like, who the fuck?
Are you serious? Yeah, I knew that shit immediately.
That was a pretty huge Easter egg. And like
I was like, it doesn't look like
I didn't see Howard the Duck, but I knew that was the kid from fucking Iron Man 3.
Yep.
I didn't recognize him. He doesn't look like he did as a kid.
Yeah, because he grown up.
Yeah, well, I wasn't tracking his puberty for the last 8 years.
He looks like the same person.
No, he doesn't. Kinda. No.
Yeah.
So that's the end of that. Why can't he try to bring all these people back? Because they're alternate timelines and shut up. So Thor, at the end, Thor joins
because the Guardians. They explained it in the movie, Joe, the movie you wrote, that they can't, it's not fucking Back to the Future.
Yep. Yeah.
All right, so funeral was good. That was a good thing. The thing with, what's his face? Happy was good with the daughter. I'm glad.
That was very cool. I'll God buy you all the Rose cheeseburgers in the world. That was super sweet.
He's so
what's that?
John Favreau is so fat.
Yeah.
He looks like shit. Directing too many Disney fucking live action movies, and he's fat.
The conversation with Scarlet Witch, where she was talking about like, you know, how they both know that everything's cool. I thought that was pretty rad.
That's fine. I mean, everybody knows Vision's coming back, so I wasn't really sad about that.
Yeah.
Because he's a robot. He's literally just a fucking disc you can turn in. He's a CD-ROM that you could just put in anything.
He's the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
But anyways, the big thing at the end was Thor on the Benatar joining the Guardians. When he actually says, as Guardians of the Galaxy, which is a real comic book, which is really funny. But I hope in Guardians 3 they kick him out like in the first 10 minutes. Like, that's my ideal scenario. Yeah. They're just like, you're annoying, get out, like, after like 10 minutes. That's because I don't want to see Thor in a whole Guardians movie. I don't. Like,
no.
I love Thor. I love Fat Thor. I love Ragnarok. I love all that stuff.
Dude, those jokes are going to fucking wear thin within like the first 5 minutes.
I want Thor out. I want just the Guardians movie. They have a lot. Guardians has a lot to wrap up. They have a lot to wrap up, and I think Thor is a distraction and unnecessary.
Yeah.
I'm not wrong, Joe.
Which hopefully they use him for distraction long enough to
get... Joe, remember when you were like, Hellboy, the Hellboy remake is going to be really good? Was I wrong about that? Was I wrong about that? I don't think so. I'm not wrong about that. I will be wrong about that. I'll never be wrong at the end. I didn't even watch that shit. Didn't get a single... I'm going to bootleg the fuck out that movie when it comes on video demand. I'm going to torrent it like it's 2005, and they ain't going to get a
single... That's what it's worth. Yeah.
Fuck that movie. Fuck everyone involved. Anyways, let's talk about the biggest issue and silliness of this movie, which is the Cap shit returning the stones, which is a whole movie they don't show you. Let's think about
probably this. A couple movies. Yeah.
Honestly, I did not mind it
because I thought it was
cool.
No, think about like okay, so a couple of them would be really easy. Returning the Power Stone is really easy because it was just sitting there, floating in a thing.
Correct.
The Time Stone, you just have to give back to the source and iteration. Hi. Everyone come back. Gotta wrap this goddamn shit up. Fucking stupid Avengers movie. Fucking eating up all of your lives and your lives. Anyone coming back? Hey, we're back. That cut us
off.
That was annoying because I was right in the middle of talking. I don't know where I left off, but let's just go right immediately back into it.
Returning stone.
Yes, the turning of the stone. So, like, easy peasy. You take the space stone back to the shield basement. That's an easy one. But, like, how did he return the scepter to Hydra?
Yeah.
With the Tesseract?
Yeah.
And did he just go and reinsert the ether back into Jane Foster? As if that was so easy? And how does he return the Soul Stone? How does that work?
I think the Hydra one was probably going to be the easiest for him because, like, he said Hail Hydra to them and he stole it. So, like, bringing it back, they might still think he's a part of Hydra. You know what I mean? Like, and he just brings it back in time like nothing ever happened. You know what I mean? Like,
I guess, but reinserting the ether back into Jane Foster.
Oh yeah, that's a tough one. Yeah.
And then also, how do you return a soul stone?
Right.
You just drop it off. Joe says you just drop it off. You just like, and then, hey, Red Skull.
And he'd have to meet up with fucking Red Skull for the first time in, what, like 70 years?
Yeah, so that would also be exactly. He's like, oh, by the way, it's you, Red Skull.
Right, here you go, bud. Like, here's this for you. I have no beef with you anymore. Like, yeah, that would be like a whole nother movie of Cap and Red Skull going at it.
I think that stuff with Cap, that stuff is silly. I get why they did all of it because you can't make the movie 10 hours long. And also, they did a character shift with Cap in that movie. He started doing very selfish things.
Yeah.
And it probably will be. You really think they're going to make another Cap movie where he's returning stones? I don't think so.
Yeah.
Is Courtney pooping? I don't know.
No, it sounds like he's making, like, cereal.
Okay, that's an interesting choice.
Yeah, it sounds like it. I heard, like, a bull rat. Oh, wait. So.
We're almost done with this goddamn movie, thank God. And then I can fucking stop talking about it because I'm tired of... Yeah, hey, Disney, I need a paycheck. Yeah. Let's make a Cap movie in time.
Good.
Hey, Josh, how was your night out with Andy and April? It was so cool that you went to go see them, even though you didn't come to see me last time I was in town. Whatever. Cool.
You might be pooping the pizza, yes.
Talk about my credit. You were great. Was that you as the openly gay character, or was that Anthony? I can't tell you the difference. Hey, welcome back.
Thank you. What?
Okay, let's talk about the whole thing with these two characters, Tony and Steve Rogers. Let's talk about it because basically what happens is they 180 flip, like, I guess character traits. So,
each other over.
That's so, like, at the beginning of these movies, Tony is selfish and self-absorbed, only does things for himself. Cap is selfless to the point of poor decision-making, almost annoying, where he's like, he's just so good and so selfless that it's kind of irritating. But by the end of this movie, Cap is kind of selfish. He makes a decision to do a selfish thing, which is live his own life despite having responsibilities. He goes back and lives his life, which is a selfish act. It's not that it's wrong or right. It is selfish because it's a self-interest move. Whereas Tony decides
to... But it's also a thing he never got to do. It's not like he had a life before. It's
still selfish because...
Is it?
Yes, because he's an Avenger and you have a job. Like, you don't just get to go, oh, well, I get this opportunity. Because you're basically, you choose between, I can go live and have sex with this lady I always liked, or I could keep being an Avenger and protecting the world. And he chose to go get laid. And I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm saying it's selfish. Not everything.
You would do the same thing. Don't fucking tell me you wouldn't.
No, yeah. Selfish doesn't always mean bad. That's what I'm saying. Selfish.
Save the world or get pooned. Like that does, you know, like saying it that way.
Or he'd say
what's more important.
He did both.
I'm just saying the way that they character flipped because Tony basically
you find that fucking dog.
Tony fucking flips and he
good job, Josh.
Selfless character and kills himself at the end. And he basically
that's true. Like
he has the option. He has a daughter and a wife to live his whole life out. He didn't have to fucking make the final fucking play. He didn't have to.
Yeah.
And Cap didn't have to go back and live his life. They swapped a little bit, and that was a character growth for both characters. Cap was annoying.
I mean, kind of Stark did have to do that, though. That was the one thing
more human. That was
gonna make
a more
it
human
happen.
Character.
Yeah,
those are like
Stark did have to do that. Like that was the one thing that fucking
didn't have to. He could have handed the fucking
the one thing
to
that
else.
Fucking. Doctor Strange told him, like, he said there was one fucking version of it, and it was a version that he fucking died in. He had to do that.
You take the gauntlet, and you immediately just give it back to Hulk and go, snap with your other arm, bitch. The end.
That wasn't the one that played out.
But he also put in that, he put himself,
No. Fucking Doctor Strange told him flat out in Infinity War, I watched a bazillion fucking scenarios and there's only one. The one where you die, shit bird.
You're also talking about a choice that was made. It's not like he just was like forced into a situation. He could have still made another choice. He made shitty, selfish choices for like three movies. And, like, was always acting that way. And this is him actually going, yes, this is the play I have to make to save everyone. And so the whole theme of Infinity War is, like, they don't want to sacrifice lives or whatever. And the only way to win is to sacrifice lives. They sacrifice Black Widow. They sacrifice Iron Man. That's the only way they fucking win. If you don't fucking sacrifice lives and kill yourself and make the hard choices, you lose.
I think secretly, like, Tony Stark knew... like, a few movies ago, that he was going to have to die. Like, that's the kind of vibe I got from him at the end of, like, Infinity War.
I don't think
like,
he thought he had to die. I thought that he planned for it. He obviously planned for it.
Yeah,
he knew that...
I think what they did in Iron Man 3, where he had, like, the freakouts about going through the wormhole and stuff, even had a factor...
Shout out Iron Man 3, one of my favorite MCU movies.
Yeah.
Where's the Mandarin?
A lot of people don't like it, but I fucking love it. I think it's great.
They didn't follow Mandarin very well, but...
I don't care about that shit. Mandarin is a stupid racist Mandarin. Character. I don't care.
They got the extremist virus quite a bit, which is cool, because that's a big part of Iron Man, actually.
And, anyway, that's the whole goddamn movie, the end.
He wants to talk about Game of Thrones.
No, I don't. I'm fucking burnt out on all this shit. Like, the last thing I want to talk about is fucking Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones was a whole other fucking thing that's, like, great, but also annoying. I don't want to get into it, so let's not even talk about it. Let's talk about
the other shit. The only thing I can say with Game of Thrones is, like, for 10 minutes straight, they actually had me saying, oh, fuck. Oh, fuck. Oh, fuck. Fuck. For, like, at least, like, 20 minutes where... I was like, fuck. Like, that was my reaction for 10 minutes straight.
Like, you want to do a bonus episode next weekend? Just do, like, an hour on Game of Thrones?
Yeah, maybe even like tomorrow, so we could do. We'll put together another time where we can get together.
And I can't do tomorrow night, but I can definitely do next Saturday.
Yeah, we'll figure it out because I can't, because that's a whole other like 2 hours, and we can't.
Yeah,
we're already like past that.
We should have known better. Plus, we're gonna have to double up on Game of Thrones because it's gonna be on tomorrow. So
yeah, it's on again tomorrow, which is annoying. It never ends.
Or tonight here because it's.
Anyways, the whole point of all these movies was so Cap could get laid. That's the whole thing.
What?
The whole point of these movies was so Cap could get laid. That was it.
Oh, is that what it was?
Yeah.
It was just like Tony had to die so Cap could go back in time and get his cherry popped. And
ugh. That's rough.
Cherry popped.
Yeah.
I can imagine, like...
I thought he boned Agent 13.
I can imagine, like... the Forrest Gump situation where, like, Captain America goes back in time and, like, all she does is just, like, touch him. And he's like,
I was coming. Like
Joe said, he's a 90-year-old fucking virgin. Like, that shit's gotta be, like, that morning wood every day for, like, 80 years. That'd be brutal.
At any point in the conversation when he went back to the 40s or whatever the fuck time he decided to start dating her again, did he not mention that he made out with her great niece?
Right. And that's Sierra another Carter? Thing. Yes.
By
yes.
the way, I made that's out with her. That's what
I'm saying. He fucking, he had sex with Agent 13.
Or,
he had sex
he's
with her.
Selfish.
After the funeral, he had sex with her. I guarantee it. He was distraught and she was.
No, because it's Captain America, and he's a Boy Scout, and, like,
oh,
his dick
belongs inside her. He had sex with my mama. Why?
That's the whole point of Endgame. Cap has become a normal person where he makes selfish choices to make himself happy.
Okay, that aside... did you think it was going to be Bucky, or did you think it was going to be Sam that became fucking Captain America?
It should have been Bucky. That's my opinion.
That's because you're a racist.
No, I'm not a fucking racist.
You guys heard it here first on Nerdicide.
Okay.
Tim's a racist.
So Captain America...
get out of my house!
Captain America passes the Falcon. Okay. Falcon's not, like, superior. Like... I mean, yeah, okay, he's...
Neither, he's black, you asshole.
God damn it, no. Because, like, he doesn't have any fucking powers. Like, I mean...
No, he doesn't.
Mind you, neither did Captain America. But like, he was pinnacle human.
Powers. He did have powers.
He was... yeah, he was pinnacle human.
They
like,
shot him up with...
right.
Power like, juice.
Falcon, okay. So what does he have?
He's got wicked wings.
He's got wings.
He's a bird that can fly out and look at things.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, like...
here's the thing, though.
That happens.
If they did a whole Captain America Falcon story.
I know they did this, but like,
that's where they were going. That's all that matters.
Winter Soldier. He should have fucking gave it to
Winter Soldier is a liability, and
yeah,
I'm sure
they'll
tackle this in the
show.
Their Disney
brain robot somehow. You can control him with mind powers.
Yeah.
And words.
I think he's over there. I think
he might be. Who knows?
Anyways. I really enjoyed the movie, as ridiculous it was. It was the most ridiculous, insane thing I've ever seen in a movie theater, and I probably will never see another movie like it. There's no way that they'll make a movie like that again. I just can't picture it. It's very strange. It's very strange.
They can do Dark Avengers. They can do fucking Secret War. They can do all that shit, and it will not be as big as this.
Yeah.
I hope they do Avengers Disassembled, where it's like more low-key teams. I also thought it was funny that, like, they managed to squeeze in Howard the Duck in that big scene, but they couldn't put the Netflix Marvel heroes in there, even for, like, a half second.
Right? Like, dude, that fucking Hard Times article where it was, like, Daredevil couldn't show because he was saving bodegas from local gangs.
Well, let's say, like, Daredevil and just fucking, like, Luke Cage, those guys show up.
Right.
That'd make me feel like, okay, that's fucking cliche. Like, I don't get
really?
It. Yeah, I wouldn't be hyped.
It would justify watching those some of those shows.
Which yeah, like but I would not, like, I would think yeah, of I it being as generic for them to show them. Like, I don't know. Like,
I understand it's.
Yeah, I'd have an all factor.
Or fucking on the outs and whatever. I understand.
But honestly, I think Cage could have taken a few punches from Thanos. I think there's shit fired to all of this.
I'm sorry, but Luke Cage is going to make the move over into the MCU. He is too cool of a character.
Yeah.
Daredevil is fine. Punisher is fine. These are fine to be away from it, but
Luke Cage, I think fucking Daredevil should be at least be in a goddamn Spider-Man movie.
I think Luke Cage should be an Avenger, like starting lineup, like out the gate. Like he is fucking, he's an Avenger. It's stupid that he's not.
Well, now that these stories have ended on Netflix and Endgame has finally fucking met its endpoint, is that something, do you think, down the line that they're going to end up doing? Is
well, they like
recasting
money.
These characters
yeah,
and,
they like money. And bringing them in? The actors or the characters was like a two-year, like they were put on like a two-year basically hiatus. No one's allowed to
yeah.
do that with them. I think that Disney likes money, so they'll fucking eventually rehash all these characters in some form or the other. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Applause. It sucks because, especially with the Daredevil show, which actually I thought the third season was really strong. Some of them were not great. Obviously, the Punisher is one of the worst things I've ever seen.
Actually, they're all going to show up in the last episode of Game of Thrones.
I hope it's just like just the only Punisher is the one who survives, so they can get some more grunting and some screaming and stuff like that.
Crying, a lot of crying. Just him beating his fucking skull into oblivion.
I'm gonna shoot this purse snatcher. And I won't shoot this guy who murdered my family for some reason. God, what a dumb show.
So, what, hey Justin, what do you feel about the new X-Men? Like,
I wish it wasn't happening. I will watch it, and it's meaningless because you just know it's like the last hurrah before they.
Yeah, really, I don't want to see that.
Right, like.
I don't care. I hate that entire cast.
Yeah.
I hate teenager X-Men in movies, yeah. And I hate that whole cast. I hate James McAvoy as fucking Professor Xavier. I am so sick of Michael Fassbender. I'm sick of all of them.
We did touch on that.
They're
a garbage pile. Like, I can't stand
it. I agree. Like, I can't wait for this to be over and then Marvel reboot it and it be amazing. Like,
that's I hope by the time they get around to it that people aren't kind of sick of superhero movies, because
right, and that's yeah.
Because after you make a
movie, I think that's like, honestly the only way that Marvel maybe may make another Endgame movie is Avengers fall to the wayside, those characters fucking go away for a while, and then we're either looking at an X-Men franchise or we're looking at a Fantastic Four franchise.
They should do a Galactus series, like Galactus as the main villain.
This like purple head, and he's like.
Well, yeah, but like the thing is, like they could do so much, like, because that would make a Fantastic Four reboot, like that would happen.
Yep.
Because and they could tie in the Ultimate Nullifier, all that fun shit, like, and then they'd be able to dive into Franklin Richards, which would be a whole nother movie as well, like. That's...
I'm just saying, I want to see a King the Conqueror movie. Shut up, asshole.
No.
I want to see a King the Conqueror movie.
Well, go make one in your backyard.
I already did.
See, I think a Galactus like Beginnings movie would be pretty cool. Like where he's still Galen on Ta before the first Big Bang. Like that'd be a cool sequence of like. A movie of him becoming Galactus. It's nerdy. I know, like, only people like me would appreciate
that shit.
Tim likes
Galactus, guys.
And I really fucking like Galactus.
Who knew?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know all of Galactus's backstory. Like, yeah. It would be a cool origin story if there was enough nerds
Turns out he was a real dude at one time.
Well, he was a fucking scientist and shit, and like trying to save his world before the pre-Big Bang, and like.
You want to hear something really dumb? I didn't know all of that. I
really? Had no clue. Yeah. And like he is brother and sister with Eternity, and like yeah, he ties in Timothy. To the cosmic. he keeps the cosmic shit in line. Like without Galactus, everything will be off tier.
So cool.
What that I'm a fucking nerd and I know everything about Galactus? Yeah, I'm sorry. Like,
you're fine. They are making a Celestials movie, so it's coming.
All a Celestial movie would be sweet.
They're making one with Angelina Jolie is going to be a Celestial. So
okay, I don't like that. I don't like that.
It's because you're a sexist.
I'm not a fucking sexist.
He's a racist just and a sexist.
Okay, Angelina Jolie. Okay, what's another celestial gonna be? Fucking Johnny Depp. Like, you know what I mean? Like that's the way I look at it.
Beats women. Angelina Jolie.
Tim Burton might as well fucking direct it at this point. Like, you know, might as well just let's do that.
All right.
Only Danny Elfman fucking does.
Danny Elfman.
He's gonna do the fucking score for that movie.
Yes.
We were supposed to have Joe come on, but I gotta get going soon, so we're not gonna do that. Joe, I love you. I'm sorry. We'll have you on another time to tell your amazing stories about directing Avengers with your brother Anthony.
Anthony's the talented one, Joe.
You're just the fucking leech sucking on the teeth of your talented brother.
All right, gang. This is where we're gonna wrap this up. Thank you for tuning in.
What? I know, boo, but I gotta go.
All right, so follow us on our respected medias, Instagrams. It's Genghis Conway.
Yes.
Paintings. _by_NFK. Twitter. What the fuck you got on Twitter, son?
It's Nerdicide 666.
Yeah, fuck that shit. Don't follow our Nerdicide shit. Just follow us. We'll lead you back to the
Nerdicide shit.
I'm kidding. It all
work into it.
All intertwines. Fingerly
scissors.
We'll try to get back to Game of Thrones another time. It's just so much to cover. It's like impossible to get through all of it at once.
It's a shit ton to cover. Yeah. But we will definitely do a Game of Thrones episode. We will not.
Before I bounce, I want to say two things. You should be watching Barry, and you should be watching What We Do in the Shadows. I'm 4 episodes caught up on What We Do in the Shadows, and it's fucking.
Yeah, I gotta get into that.
Everyone should be watching this show. It's so funny. It's just as good as the movie. So fucking funny. So funny.
Well, that's the endorsement I wanted to hear because I haven't talked to anybody about that show yet, and that's all I wanted to hear is that it's just like the movie. So
fucking funny. I keep popping into my head at random times the one vampire and the things he says, and it's good, repeatable.
I heard Doug Jones is on that.
Huh?
I heard Doug Jones is on that.
I think, he plays like the old-timey vampire demon-y
guy. Yeah.
Yeah. It's really well done. Everyone should be watching. It's on FX, and you can watch it on most places on demand if you have cable. So.
Cool.
But I gotta go. I gotta pee, and then I'm gonna go outside and burn a fire. It. Tim, thanks for stopping by. It's good to see
you. Hey, no problem, man. It's been fun. Yeah.
Super fun. Joe Russo, we'll get back to you another night. And
definitely, Joe.
I'm going to go and enjoy the rest of my night like a normal person.
Yeah, mine's over, dickhole.
I should be sleeping. Yeah.
All right.
Later, boo.
You guys have a good night, and we will see you soon. Goodbye.
Love you.
Bye.